Welcome, welcome, and welcome. Fresh off our first live gig, we are the Podcast Pediatricians. I'm Rob Walter.
And I'm Matt Gotthold.
And Merry Christmas, and Happy Hanukkah, and Happy New Year. And we hope to get that video of the Christiana Pediatric Grand Rounds up on YouTube real soon. So check out podcastpediatricians.com. But it went pretty well.
Yeah,
what do you think,
yeah,
Matt?
We were a little, you know, could work on our timing.
We
know.
Could. We dressed up nicely.
Tried to jam about. Don't we always?
Except Matt wore his red Crocs.
Don't I always?
Right.
So all right, go back to something. Are you a CH Hanukkah guy or an H Hanukkah guy?
I'm an H Hanukkah guy.
And what is the difference there? Being new to this, you know, whole Judaism thing.
If you have allergies and how much phlegm you have in the back of your throat. Nice. If you're an allergic kind of Jewish guy, you're like Hanukkah. If you already had your sinuses to open by the local ENT, it's just Hanukkah.
Oh, okay. I'm glad you straightened that out for me.
It's a religious thing. I have to sadly admit that at the end of a grand round, we took a straw poll on Bruce versus Billy. Mm-hmm. And
say it, Rob.
And Bruce,
say it.
And Bruce won.
Yes, he did.
Pediatric audience, I don't feel they're very sophisticated.
I think we have to say that Bruce won handily.
I know. Mm-hmm. It was hard. All right. Well, today's episode is a cutting edge topic, literally. The phrenotomy epidemic. Tongue ties, lip ties, buckle ties. Oh, my.
Oh, my.
Special thanks to one of our listeners from Ravens Country, nurse practitioner Missy, who turned us on to this issue. And my thanks to Angela, who taught me a lot about lactation. Anything we get wrong in this episode is on us.
Always.
Always.
It's always on us.
Always.
When we get things wrong.
And since we're in a newborn state of mind.
Without them. Oh, come on, if you're going to proclaim to be a Billy Joel
Stranger?
Expert, wrong, Turnstiles.
Oh, and it's my favorite album is Turnstiles. I'm not.
Yeah,
I'm
obviously.
Not, it's not like Diner where I just like memorize where each song is, but yeah, that was pathetic. All right. And I won't edit that out. Yeah. We're going to drop this episode, and then our next episode will be called Baby Friendly Sad Mommy. So I think most pediatric caregivers can figure that out.
Particular alert.
And so, Matt, you still do well babies, right?
Oh, you bet. Yeah. I love bonding with the families in the hospital, getting to know them a little bit before they come to see me in the office. And really, to be honest with you, I enjoy the whole maternity ward and all the nurses there. It's like
I know. The clerks,
it's like
it's
a nice
fun.
Little social network.
They're
yeah,
so
and it is
good.
Fun.
They're so nice.
And they're good to us.
Right.
Always.
We really like doing the babies. It's fun. We got that newborn smell thing going on.
Yeah, yeah. Which newborn smell would be that?
the babies.
The meconium. The unbathed fathers.
Oh, that's a different smell. But the meconium doesn't smell. It's like poop that doesn't smell.
Well, it depends on the circumstances.
Okay. And did you know, Matt, that in our main hospital that has the maternity ward, not the children's hospital, the hospice have taken over all adult admissions? With very few exceptions.
Yeah, I'd seen that. I'd heard that. And thankfully for us, most hierarchy and administration in medicine don't really consider pediatricians to be real doctors. So they still let us in the door.
We don't want to give up those babies. And when they come for our babies, they'll have to rip them out of our cold, dead hands.
Ew.
I know that was a bad soundbite. But suffice to say that we hope to continue to see our own babies. It really sets a tone for their whole childhood that we're their doctor from day one. Here we go, the phrenotomy epidemic. The number of phrenotomies in the United States has increased 866% from 1997 to 2012, per the Head and Neck Surgery Journal article by Walsh et al., published in 2017. This sounds like a lot, but I think this is a gross underestimation of the increase, especially in certain pockets of the Northeast, and apparently especially in the suburban Baltimore area. Now, remember that all references for each episode is on our website, podcastpediatricians.com, where you can sign up for bonus material and give us feedback and suggestions like we got for these two newborn episodes. If you like this podcast, tell your friends and colleagues. Again, for these next two, especially tell any new moms, lactation specialists, neonatologists, and even the laser dentist and baby-friendly activists, especially if you think they'll be mad, have them listen. We'd love it.
And then have them get back to us.
Right.
So we are also on iTunes, Google Play, TuneIn, Stitcher, And apparently Rob had recently gotten us on his TV through his Amazon Fire Stick, because he's all about multimedia.
And got tuned in. I was very excited.
And like us on Facebook and check us out on YouTube soon, where we hope to have our first YouTube video in addition to the YouTube auditory stuff we already have posted.
All right, Matt, you're the best at the disclaimer.
Okay, so...
to rip it off the wall.
Rip it off the wall where we keep it. We are sharing our own personal opinions on pediatric care. Always talk to your own pediatric caregiver about your child. Pediatric caregivers should always consult expert guidelines and consider their own community's standards of care. For this discussion, the term frenotomy will include both the more common division of the frenulum and the total frenectomy, which is the obliteration of the frenulum, often by a laser. There are a multitude of terms for this. You know, frenotomy is the one that we'll use, but it's also known as a frenectomy, a frenulectomy. So just for the you non-medical folks out there, otomy means to cut or to incise, and ectomy means to remove.
Destroy.
Or to take out. So the human body comes in many glorious variations of shapes molded by thousands of years of evolution or intelligent design, you know, if you will. And naturally, there's an incredibly wide range of normal variations in a newborn's oral connective tissue. Since we were designed to breastfeed to live, it seems doubtful that a large percentage of newborns would require surgical procedures in order to breastfeed. We all naturally have a frenulum, or attachment, at the base of our tongues. This is called the lingual frenulum. There's also another frenulum in the center of the upper lip connected to the gums, which is called the maxillary labial frenulum. So frenulum, when I was checking this out, Rob, I thought this was pretty cool. Frenulum is actually Latin for little bridle. So it actually kind of reins in. The tongue reins in the upper lip. So to a degree, there's supposed to be some element of restriction there, or else we'd all be walking around like anteaters or like Gene Simmons. You know? So to that extent, there is a purpose for this frenulum. What we're going to discuss over the next couple minutes or so is, to what degree do we want to mess around with that?
So first off, I think Matt just admitted he's a KISS fan. Didn't know that. Second,
knowing what somebody is.
little bridle on the horse fit, not like a little like groom and bridal shower.
Little bridle.
In white.
Yes.
Okay, I got
yes.
you. So if the tongue frenulum is short and or significantly restricts the movement of the tongue, it's called ankyloglossia or tongue tie. Often when you sweep your finger under the tongue in a newborn and cannot feel a good space between the tongue and the bottom of the mouth, that means that there is some restriction. Now, if the lip labial frenulum and the upper lip is tight, some people call this a lip tie. Recently, some clinicians have described something called a buccal tie or a lateral frenulum, where there's mucosal attachments tethered from the cheeks to the gingiva, apparently, Matt, diagnosed by phone.
Yeah, I had this really very dedicated and exhausted mom telling me that she had been in contact with somebody who was an expert in New England. And to me, they sounded like they were cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, to be honest with you. But they had told this mom that the baby had a buccal frenulum problem. And to me, as far as I know, I it was a term I had never, ever heard before. So the fact that your gum is connected to your cheek seems to be the way it's supposed to work.
For Homo sapiens.
For those of us who, you know, put things in our mouths, you don't want it falling out the sides. So in that context, I think that you know, some of these things have really been taken quite too far.
Right. Now, there are variations to everything. I'm sure rarely there are some times when there is a abnormal connection of the buccal mucosa, but it must be very, 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 very rare.
The classic unmistakable tongue tie is a thin membrane or a short frenulum from the floor of the mouth to almost the tip of the tongue or to the tip of the tongue. And what this creates for those of us who look inside babies' mouths is a heart-shaped appearing tongue that in most cases pediatric caregivers have seen in their practice, and it occurs somewhere in the ballpark of 4 to 5% of the time. So when we see this type of thing, we're on the lookout for any issues, but it doesn't necessarily infer to us that the baby needs to have this addressed.
Exactly. But in a seminal paper from 2005 in the Archives of Diseases in Children, it was reported that snipping this type of classic tongue tie, again, about 4 to 5% of babies, can greatly improve breastfeeding where there is associated breastfeeding difficulties, which includes pain. And I think I can speak for Matt that we completely agree that this does exist.
Yeah.
We were both classically trained in the 80s that most tongue ties stretch out over time, especially if the child can get their tongue past their lips. But absolutely, in some cases, especially with those classic tongue ties and difficulty breastfeeding, watchful waiting may not be good enough. Sometimes the procedure to clip that tongue tie makes sense. And we were not taught this at all.
No.
And we learned this in our practice. Certainly for this classic tongue tie in a newborn, you first do interventions with positioning and get the breastfeeding specialist involved. And as we said, sometimes it makes sense to fix this. Although in a Cochrane review in March of 2017, they rated the quality of research in this whole area as very low and stated that any surgical release of tongue ties to improve breastfeeding is not supported by the evidence, although it may help improve nipple pain.
Yeah, and just to be clear for those folks who aren't familiar with the term Cochrane review, so Cochrane is an organization. It's a nonprofit, non-governmental organization, and it's been formed to organize medical findings, and it serves to facilitate evidence-based choices about health interventions, really based on the research by healthcare professionals, by research by people who are involved with the academia of it, and really they have no allegiance to anyone. So when the Cochrane Review makes a statement, it's really very well considered and very well thought out. You know, there's really no evidence that there is a compelling reason to be doing all these frenotomies.
Right, although, to be fair, what they said was that the research is terrible, so there isn't great evidence either way, and that has to be fair, that has to be taken into account. So again, the main problem is that the research in this area sucks. Mm-hmm. And more frenotomies are being done for non-classic tongue ties, like posterior tongue ties, and for lip ties based on no good evidence.
Yeah, and it really comes down to evidence, and that's really why we as practitioners really try to consider not just what we see and what we know, but really what the science tells us. And in this situation, at least, there isn't compelling evidence that this is something that needs to be done.
And the big reason for the suckiness of research is that the definitions of what a tongue tie is all over the place. So the classic tongue tie is lumped with a posterior tongue tie and even those lip ties. With no uniform definition of the type of tongue attachments, any study would then be worthless. And even the term posterior tongue tie is confusing because you're really talking about the anterior part of the genial glossus muscle. Now, proponents of frenotomies, especially those laser dentists, do not seem to want to do better studies. Many of them claim that it's unethical to do blinded controlled studies since it's so clear to them that it helps in their case reports.
Yeah, but we also know that often breastfeeding gets better anyway as babies learn how to latch and moms learn better holding techniques and better strategies otherwise, usually from the fabulous lactation consultants who get involved.
There's bound to be a really big placebo effect of these laser case reports because these procedures are expensive and painful, and so the parents really, really want it to be worthwhile. And that's why we need to do controlled blinded studies.
Yes, claiming that frenectomies work because they seem to work is not science. It's charlatanism. Even in controversial areas that we've talked about, like using steroids for croup, which was not supported at all by early studies, we knew that more studies were being conducted, and ultimately the benefit was proven. We need to do that type of research with newborn frenotomies.
Many claim that behind every tight anterior frenulum is a tight posterior frenulum, which is promoted by these practitioners and again really muddies the water. Careful studies need to be done, and we shouldn't just experiment on newborns with procedures that are often done without anesthesia, I might add. And let me tell you, laser frenotomies do hurt. We get the phone calls that night from the parents who find that their children are really fussy and seeming to be in pain. If I was being cynical, I would suggest that maybe the studies are not being supported since they don't want to prove that many of these frenotomies are not needed. It is a big and growing revenue source and mostly cash on the barrel. But hey, I'm not a cynical guy.
Isn't that a song?
The number of frenotomies in the United States has increased 866% from 1997 to 2012, per the Head and Neck Surgery Journal article by Walsh et al., published in 2017. This sounds like a lot, but I think this is a gross underestimation of the increase. Matt, are you seeing this increase?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, again, some of these frenectomies seem to be necessary and they're helpful, but many are not. And it really confuses and concerns new parents who are really kind of putty in the hands of not just we pediatricians, because they're really looking for advice, but when they're told that something could be helpful to their baby who seems to be crying more than they expect them to, or just acting out of sorts, and this seems to be the panacea, it's very confusing to them.
And a lot of these referrals for the procedure come from lactation consultants and the dentists who are using the lasers, plus also from maternity ward consults to hospital ENTs and oral maxillofacial teams, perhaps fueled by the baby-friendly hospital programs. Yes, more on that next time.
There seems to be a growing eagerness to jump into frenotomies earlier and earlier, even for non-classic tongue ties and for lip ties, while making claims of wide-ranging frenotomy benefits that aren't based on scientific evidence. This includes claims of improved speech, which may be true in extreme cases, but not in most cases, and even claiming faster acquisition of language, which makes no sense. Proponents of this also claim that it decreases gastroesophageal reflux, but as we have mentioned, spitting up in newborns is normal.
Newborns spit.
They do. They also claim it can prevent future eating issues, future developmental issues, and future tooth decay, while improving posture and mood and the ability to detoxify, and can even increase one's chance of winning the lottery, apparently. So there are all kinds of goodies.
Apparently.
You know.
Just Google detoxify and frenotomies. For the newborn baby with a tongue tie who is only perhaps having some difficulties breastfeeding, there is no evidence of any benefit for doing additional invasive, painful, expensive procedures like lip frenotomies. Often, if there is a bit of an anterior tongue tie, the laser docs will also offer to that new mom to fix any deeper posterior tongue ties, and then, most frustrating to us, talk those new parents into getting that lip tie repair for an extra $300 that's usually not covered, and again, causes some extra pain. Okay, we've mentioned lip ties enough. Let's talk about those lip ties. A newborn baby does not need to phalange his or her upper lip in order to breastfeed successfully. All human beings will retract their upper lip when they stick their tongue out as far as possible. If you've ever French kissed, you would know that. Do they French kiss in South Jersey?
No, we Jersey kiss. but
I don't,
as
I don't know what that is.
As a New Jerseyan, I am sworn to secrecy in this technique. But as clearly indicated by the fact that Jersey is the most densely populated state in the country, it seems to work just fine for us.
You can't really move around without French kissing somebody. They're so tightly packed. And actually, little known fact, French kissing was invented in Syosset, Long Island in 1949 in the back of a Carvel on Jericho Turnpike. Now you know.
By some relative of yours? Nice.
So, again, you don't need to phalange your upper lip to breastfeed.
Wait, what is phalange your lip?
Phalange, which means pull your lip backwards so it goes up towards your nose. And there's this thought that, well, to breastfeed, a baby has to be able to phalange that upper lip backwards so he can get around the nipple. But that's just not true.
Like curl your upper lip up, right? Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, we call that monkey face at my house.
Yes, a thick lip frenulum can lead to a space between the upper incisors or front teeth, and this trait is often passed down from generation to generation in some families, and it's mostly a cosmetic issue. Now, most commonly in the old days of 5 years ago, a lot of these children with a thick frenulum would run around and fall during childhood and rip that frenulum, and the problem was taken care of. In a few instances, it was a problem later with that space between their front teeth, and the dentists and ENTs addressed it.
Now, it was explained to me, at least at some point by a dentist, that they would prefer to see that gapper in the front than necessarily teeth that were otherwise placed, particularly teeth that were too close together. So my understanding of this was that to an extent, it's an advantage to have that frenulum there, to have that gap there when you're talking about future orthodontics or dentition.
And cavities. And obviously the front incisors and the front teeth and the maxillary upper side are the most common for child cavities. And the more space you have between the teeth, the less chance you have to have cavities.
Mm-hmm.
Now, after these lip tie procedures are done, there's often lots of recommendations for tongue and lip stretching to help. I don't think there's any evidence that it does anything, but that's another thing that's being promoted.
No, it's another thing that seems to make sense, but like, show me the evidence.
okay, so what's a pediatric caregiver to do in this age of frenotomies gone wild? Most importantly, have a close working relationship with your lactation consultants. This is invaluable. But discuss the issues of frenotomies that we are covering today with those lactation specialists and make sure you're on the same page about it. Your lactation consultants should be discussing with you any referrals they make to get a surgical procedure. Now, we do have one in our office and it's wonderful, but most pediatricians don't. Again, having a working relationship with the main ones in your community, I think, makes a lot of sense and really helps our patients. And you moms out there, feel free to discuss with us any referrals you get from anyone about your baby for a surgical procedure. We want to make sure it makes sense, and we do not always know when the consultant is referring to another consultant, so call us. The lactation specialist actually is watching the breastfeeding dyad in real time, which most of the pediatric caregivers like us and the dentists and the ENTs do not really do. So their input is most important of all. But again, share your concerns with them about not overdoing invasive, painful, and expensive procedures on your newborn. And for pediatric caregivers, we should always do a careful exam under the tongue and even under the upper lip when you first see that baby in the hospital. Now, if you find that classical anterior tongue tie with a heart-shaped tongue and really tight to the tip, then certainly let the lactation consultant in the hospital and nurses and mom know that it may need to be addressed. And sometimes, honestly, it can be best addressed in these cases in the hospital if it's clearly affecting latching and breastfeeding. However, if you find a mild tongue tie, mostly posterior, or you see a prominent labial lip frenulum but no blanching, I usually just tell mom about it and that it likely will not affect your breastfeeding and that we should both follow it closely. But I've gotten to the point where I don't tell the nurses on the floor about it. I don't document these mild findings in the chart, or else we'll turn around the next day and someone's been consulted and they've already done a surgical procedure on the baby. We should make sure, again, that hospital maternity nurses and personnel don't order consults for ENT or oral maxillary surgery or dentists without discussing it with the primary caregiver, which is usually us. Of course, if I don't think it's necessary but the parents want it, then absolutely they'll go ahead and do it.
But at least by that point, they've heard your side of it or our side of it. You know, right. I also tell parents that this isn't something that you necessarily have to jump into. There are plenty of opportunities to have this done as an outpatient. It doesn't have to be done in the hospital. And so if there's any question at all, you know, like so many other things in the pediatric world, watchful waiting is oftentimes a decent approach to it.
Exactly. And to be clear, again, we do think there are absolutely times when even there may be non-classic, more posterior tongue ties that need to be addressed with a procedure. And there's even nice ultrasound footage of how these may affect breastfeeding in an individual child, but that doesn't mean it's every child. And yes, I've seen babies with posterior type tongue ties, and they've had the procedure after the lactation consultant agrees it's needed, and everything is much better. And it's usually done by laser. But we've also seen cases where it didn't work well, or the parents did not feel it was worth the pain or expense and felt pressured to do it. Any comments about that, Matt?
And just to reiterate one more time, this type of a procedure is being dramatically overdone, and we really like to be involved in the decision-making process here. You know, we don't like to have necessarily a parent's friend or a floor nurse without consulting us or even a lactation consultant move forward with this without at least discussing it with us.
And brings us, lastly, one more time to talk about those lip ties. Rarely, and only severe lip ties might there be a problem with breastfeeding as determined by an actual expert watching the breastfeeding. And really only if that upper frenulum clearly blanches when you lift the upper lift. If the lactation consultant feels it's an issue, then it should be acted upon perhaps. But if it's not an issue, per the lactation expert, then the dentist and ENT should not talk moms into doing it as an add-on to the tongue frenotomy. Any moms out there should be forewarned about this. I tell moms about that specifically. And most importantly, talk to your referral ENTs and especially your dental colleagues. The use of lasers is only going to grow. And right now, it's mostly the dentists, but I assume the ENTs and OMFs will get into it too. We are certainly in a flux of when clinical practice with new tools, the lasers, are getting ahead of clinical evidence-based research. There was just a big two-day CME course on doing newborn phrenotomies for dentists in Washington, D.C. a couple weeks ago. This issue will only grow. Make it clear to those laser practitioners that when you send a child for a tongue laser phrenotomy based on a breastfeeding problem identified by lactation consultants, you do not expect the child to end up with an upper lip laser phrenotomy thrown in.
Yeah, while I'm here, for an extra $300, I can take care of that upper frenulum for you.
Door number two.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That newborn would never have made it to see that dentist or ENT without having breastfeeding issues that certainly had nothing to do with a lip tie, just the tongue. If the laser docs feel strongly about it, they should call us. Now, this conversation with our colleagues is difficult. I don't question that the dentists, ENTs, and OMFs are also trying to do what's best for babies and that this is an area of expertise for them. I try to give these consultants specific written instructions on what we are referring the baby for and what we expect for that baby. And actually, a nice written referral form was recently provided by our main practitioner of laser phrenotomies, which is great. I try to get feedback from the moms, and even trying to keep a log, which we just started to do, of referrals for phrenotomies can help in conjunction with your lactation consultant. If your babies are referred for simple tongue phrenotomies and continue to get additional procedures that are not requested, then change your referral pattern. When phrenotomy rates start approaching 10% and beyond, we really have to reassess why they are being done. It's hard to imagine that so many human newborns would require a surgical procedure to be able to naturally breastfeed.
We'll be right back with a newborn product endorsement and then end on those seven words banned by the CDC. Okay, we have a podcast pediatrician product endorsement. Drum roll, please. Hit it, Rob.
We really, really, really like the all-purpose nipple ointment, or as it's known in the trade, Apno, or the triple nipple ointment. This can be a rather miracle cure for most sore nipples with breastfeeding. It was created by the breastfeeding guru, Dr. Jack Newman, who, as it turns out, is the father of the most famous postal worker in the world, Norman Newman, or, as he's known to his friends,
Newman.
Yeah, all-purpose. So the all-purpose nipple ointment is a combination of three different ingredients. First, there's mupirocin, 2% ointment, otherwise known as Bactroban, and this helps against bacteria like staph and may even help against candida. Do you know what candida translates to in Latin?
No.
So it translates to brilliantly white, which is why they named the white cheesy Candida albicans after it, that bacteria.
I guess the other translation could be terrible smell. That would be the other guess I might have
for
had.
For sure. Uh-huh.
And the song? You know the song?
What song?
Oh, Candida, we could make it together.
Yeah.
The air is fresh and clean.
You know, like, oh, you know the lyrics
Tony
to that
Orlando
1970s
and,
gem.
And Dawn.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Over the years, this association with yeast, not Tony Orlando's, but Candida and nipple action, has really put a damper on naming new baby girls Candida, dropping off the rating scales decades ago.
I looked it up. It's like 25,000 most popular.
I didn't even. Isn't that a novel?
It's
or
like
a
below
book by,
it's a below Ethel and Adolf, I think.
Does that have anything to do with, was it Voltaire who wrote Candide?
Candide.
Yes. Yeah. Surely there's a relation there. Yep. Yeah, Ethel and Adolf are not exactly popular items anymore in the naming category. So mupirocin is the first ingredient, but the second ingredient after mupirocin is betamethasone 0.1% ointment. And this helps with inflammation in that area. And then the last ingredient is a myconazole powder to a concentration of about 2%. This is an antifungal against things like Candida. You can also substitute fluconazole powder or clotrimazole powder to, again, make a 2% concentration.
The all-purpose nipple ointment is prescription. It must be compounded by the pharmacy. I can't figure out how to put it in the EMR, so right now I handwrite it. You write the prescription as mupirocin 2%, 15 grams, plus betamethasone ointment 0.1%, 15 grams, and then write to add miconazole powder to a concentration of 2%. So a total of 30 grams of ointment combined, and it should be applied sparingly to the sore nipples after feeding. It should not be wiped or washed off. Most gets absorbed into the mom's skin, and any leftover will not be harmful to the baby. Obviously, you should stop using it if it causes more pain.
I got to tell you, this one was a completely new one to me. I mean, you talk about like this as though you, this is something that we should all know about. And honestly, I knew very little about it until you told me about it.
Again, mm-hmm. I give the credit to Angela. Again, if you got it wrong, it's not my fault, but it's our lactation consultant. And she just lights up when she talks about the all-purpose nipple wow. ointment.
So you, as with having a lactation consultant in your office, it makes it a little bit easier for you to step in and prescribe for moms. I'm always a little bit, you know, leery about how much I should do for an adult patient, you know, especially since they're outside my,
you know, and I honestly don't like to do that very often. The one time it comes up is when it's requested that I prescribe Diflucan mm-hmm. for fungal infections that are more severe around the mom's nipples. And I don't like to, but if the rare times when they can't get the OB or the mom's primary doctor mm-hmm. to do it, then prescribe a few doses of oral pills, Diflucan, for the mom. Mm-hmm. And it does really help. What I won't do is treat young newborns for thrush just because the mom has a candidal nipple infection. If the baby has absolutely, absolutely no signs of thrush at all, a little whitish tongue in a breastfeeding baby with nothing in the buccal mucosa is not oral thrush. Now, what do you use, Matt, for oral thrush in babies?
To treat it, more often than not, I'll start out with the traditional nystatin, you know, 1 mL into each cheek pouch, although they have to be pretty specific to the parents in terms of how to do this for a newborn. But I will, you know, not uncommonly also use Diflucan if I feel like I'm not getting anywhere.
Yeah, over the years, I've jumped to Diflucan quicker when the oral nystatin isn't working. And that's a two-week course mm-hmm. once a day, and you don't have to get it on the lesions. It's just they swallow it, right. So it's easier to give. Now, here's my question. Do you ever use gentian violet for thrush?
I haven't used it in years. I know that's still big among some of the more holistic practitioners. To me, it always made the babies look like they were like grape juice vampires, because they're just their mouth is like oozing with this purplish, you know, saliva.
It's like an extra out of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Absolutely.
But I never use it. To me, it's almost like medieval. There are uncommon times you can get this wicked, painful irritation of the mouth from gentian violet. I've seen a couple of babies with it. One almost got admitted for dehydration. So there are other things out there that don't have this high risk to me of side effects. So I stay away from it, and when I see someone who's been treated for it, I basically say, you know, mm-hmm. just call me first. I would stay away from it.
Yeah. How often do you see situations where parents are under the impression that something is thrush when you think it is not?
Oh, often. I mean, again, mm-hmm. anything white on the tongue, it's thrush.
Right.
And you have to say, you know, it really isn't.
Yeah. It really, you know, unless I'm really compelled with this very thick, mossy look to the tongue, independent of the rest of the insides of the mouth. I mean, first of all, I mean, if the buccal mucosa is involved, if the palate is involved,
then
if the inner lips are involved, right. then sure, that's more compelling evidence. But just, you know, white debris on the tongue is honestly just white debris on the tongue. And oftentimes it's just milk debris. So I think we have to be careful about over-treating that, because I think oftentimes it's over-treated. And like so many other things that tend to be over-treated in medicine, when it's, quote, not getting better with the treatment, then people tend to step it up to the next stronger thing. That's the time to take a step backwards and say, wait a minute, is this really thrush?
Exactly. And of course, this all-purpose nipple ointment is great, but obviously the best solution is preventing sore nipples in the first place. And we can't stress enough that having a lactation consultant from early on is invaluable. We'll be right back. Oh, Candida, we could make it together. The further from here, girl, the better. Where the air is fresh and clean.
Back. So our podcast is about pediatric care mixed in with some popular culture rambling and whatnot. We don't get too political, but it's hard to ignore in the recent scary bizarro world the dictate that came out of the Centers for Disease Control recently. The current administration is banning seven words or phrases in their budget documents. These notorious seven are, pay close attention to this, vulnerable, entitlement, diversity, transgender, fetus, evidence-based, and science-based. In the place of the evidence and science-based, the CDC recommends saying that the CDC bases its recommendations on, quote, science in consideration with community standards and wishes. So, what they're really saying here is, this is science as long as it's okay with you guys.
Wow. I just think, wow. There is no way not to consider this an Orwellian policy. And this edict seems to come from the overseeing Department of Health and Human Services, and they are spinning it that it's just for budget requests to be more palatable to certain members of Congress. But the FDA did not get these directives. And how messed up is it that we should not use words like this, scientific words, for congressmen and congresswomen when we're talking about science? Banning words and questioning science is chilling.
I mean, we're not talking about like dirty words or racial epithets or anything along that lines. These are words that we who are involved in science use routinely.
Exactly. And also a big target seems to be LGBT community and specifically transgender.
Wow. It was really nice to see that the American Academy of Pediatrics CEO, Karen Remley, immediately put out a statement of shock at these actions, as did the Pediatric Infectious Disease Society, and just about everybody in organized medicine, including researchers and public health officials.
And maybe it's just my weirdness, or it is my weirdness. When I first heard about the seven words, all I could think of was those other seven words. George Carlin's Seven Words You Cannot Say on TV, which he actually stole from Lenny Bruce. That routine was part of a stand-up comedy routine. This CDC edict is part of a sadder, real-life comical farce.
It's like a situation where when comedy becomes reality. Yeah, that's what we're dealing with here.
And speaking of Lenny Bruce, he's a character in the new Amazon series, The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, in which Rachel Brosnahan and the entire show are, yes, truly marvelous. Plus, there's Tony Shalhoub of Monk fame, who also stars in the new musical, A Band's Visit, which will win the 2018 award for Best Musical. So I'm
bold
going.
Bold prediction, Rob.
Bold prediction. You want to come with me? There's still tickets left, Matt. You want to come to Broadway?
I might consider that.
Okay. I mean, I went to the Ripe concert with you.
Yes, you did. And was it worth your while?
It was. Well, I have to admit. So Matt said, this is a great group. They're from Boston. They all graduated from Berkeley. So I'm thinking, all right, they're all tech nerds who graduated from Cal Berkeley, and they made a band. And it wasn't like till I'm sitting there that they made a reference that they went to the Berklee School of Music.
Yes, quite a difference there.
Yeah, a little bit of a difference. And you know, it's new, but their lead singer was good. They're engaging in amazing trumpets and brass section. But what got me is they did their first cover they did was of the Kinks' Lola.
Yes.
And I was like, oh, that's good.
Uh-huh.
And then I started listening to the rest of their music. So
no, it was a completely energized evening, I would say. Anytime that you find, now, we went with our friend Lou as well.
Big Lou.
and Lou tends not to bounce. But Rob and I bounced up and down during a couple of the tunes, which is not easy for us mid-50s guys. But it was that wonderful.
We were doing like a Grateful Dead audience imitation there.
You betcha.
All right, so
check them out, Ripe.
Ripe.
I know they have an EP on iTunes.
Yes, they're really good, and they're up and coming. Get ready. Next, we're going to hit you with baby-friendly Sad Mommy as we go on to 2018. So say goodnight, Matt.
Good night, Rob.
Good.
I met her in the club down in Old Soho, where you drink champagne and it tastes just like cherry cola, C-O-L-A cola. She walked up to me and she asked me to dance. I asked her her name and in a dark brown voice she said Lola, L-O-L-A Lola, la 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 la. We'll be right back.
podcast, Pediatricians Productions. All rights reserved.